There is a new book in town. It helps to deal with scourge of depression. The title, Deep Expression, is a transformative book that weaves an electrifying tale of loss, grief, love, and redemption. The story of the character Brenda awakens us to the menace and claws of depression in its organic progression, all the way to its full evolution. While addressing some deep-seated issues and preconceived societal constructs, it is an important conversation and an essential body of work for anyone who wants to go beyond the awareness of mental health, especially depression. But it seeks to take it head on. Well, find out how courage, faith, tenacity, and resilience play out in this unforgettable and inspiring story. To talk to us more about this interesting book is the author, Dr. Maimuna Kadri. Thank you so much for coming on Newsday.
Thank you.
It sounds like an interesting book already. Inspired by real life stories and chronicles relatable events around depression.
Yes.
And that's one subject you know so much about as one of the very few practicing psychiatrists and psychologists in Nigeria. But how best would you describe this book? And what inspired you to now write a book?
So I wouldn't want to go through a very long description. Mm-hmm. I would just go to me being a five-year-old and my grandmom telling me I've got a voice, and if I use my voice well, it will change a lot of lives. And then the very first time I was on stage talking to over 1,000 participants, I came down from that stage and almost half of the hall were asking me, do I have something they can take away with, not just this discussion I just had with them. And I looked like, look, I'm a doctor. I've just come to deliver my talk on mental health awareness. What else do I need to have again? Don't you have a book? And that was when it occurred to me that, okay, I could actually put my stories from the staples of a shrink into a book, and not necessarily using names of my clients and patients, but generally creating more awareness on mental health and normalizing mental health conversation. So this led to this book. And of course, when COVID happened last year, with all the hustle and bustle and the world was on a lockdown, I was able to bring life into the book.
Okay, very interesting. Who knows, the book might be made into a movie because it's certainly an important conversation to be had. But when I look at your summary of your book or the summary we just heard, it suggests that depression has a genesis, which we all suspect. Yeah. What role, if you can help enlighten us on this, do societal constructs play in all of this?
So my story has a lead character, Brenda, who grew up with two other siblings and from one second away from the road, there was an accident and she lost a sibling. And she was a big influencer online with various platforms she was on, Instagram, TikTok. And this sibling she lost was the major, like, unofficial camera woman and all the things that came with it. And by the time she had that accident, the stories online were all coming to her. Like, she was not online because she was burnt. She was not online because there was something wrong with her. And then, of course, her friends even abandoned her at that point in time because she couldn't show her face. She's a burnt survivor. And all the comments online drove her to have depression. Not only that, she became suicidal. So there's a lot that the society can play when it comes, the role the society can play when it comes to mental health awareness. The fact that we should be able to create a culture of compassion where people can be able to speak up, speak out, and get help from the much, you know, from what they are going through, as against making flimsy statements like, if she wants to die, let her die. Or she wants to take sniper, she can go to this market and go and buy it. Doesn't she know that Yasikira is selling it? So those comments, you don't know who you are speaking with. You are behind the scene with your phone and your keyboards and typing away, but somebody whose personality doesn't really agree with you is feeling that there's something truly wrong with him or her, and that can affect that person negatively. So at this point in time, deep expression is just bringing to light that mental health is as important as our physical health, and is intrinsically linked, and it's not fake news, and we should take it as, you know, as it is that we deal with our physical health. And of course, building that culture of compassion should encourage help-seeking behavior. Don't be in denial if you're having issues. Of course, if somebody comes to you and say he or she is having issues, don't trivialize that person's challenges, because no one, absolutely no one, is immune to having a mental health-related challenge. And there is no vaccine as of today that is in the pipeline that we can take and say you will not have a mental health issue.
Thank you for reminding us of that. And I was just going to ask you, how do we do this as a society? I guess you started answering that question, because for humans, I also think it's normal to say, if you don't see it, you don't believe it. And so when it comes to mental health, you don't run a temperature, you don't have sores, you can't see it. So how do we solve what we can't see?
Awesome. I love that particular question, because aside from mental related issues, there are other non-communicable diseases like cancer. Do we see cancer? We don't see cancer. But somebody is just telling you, I've got cancer. The next thing, either you are teary or you are being empathetic or sympathetic with this individual. You are asking a million and one questions on where to get help, going on Google to go and help the person get help. Why don't we do that for people living with mental illnesses? There's the letter S. Why those with cancer, diabetes, hypertension are being, people sympathize with them. The flip side of this is, those with depression, bipolar affective disorder are being stigmatized. We can flip it. The reason why mental health is still highly discriminated and stigmatized in our society is because we are not normalizing these conversations. In schools, in workplaces, at home, this book is a family read. So it's not for children or for adolescents or for older people, is for everybody. Read it, start a conversation with your children. Get your children to also read it so that everybody can be on a round table and discuss even those things that you are not seeing, especially for our parents, because they will come asking those questions. How will I know that my child is depressed? When you start that conversation, but one caveat, as a parent, be a non-judgmental listener. That is the only way you can get your children to express themselves to you, because during our focus group discussion while writing this book, we had a lot of adolescents and young adults expressing themselves in different ways, and sometimes we had parents with them in those discussions and they were blown away with what their children have been going through, but they didn't know that they were going through these issues.
As a parent, I feel I can identify. I'm already putting myself in their shoes. But you say be a non-judgmental listener, and there's another word you used, normalize the conversations. I'm intrigued because as part of the description of your book, you talked about it as a story of courage, faith, tenacity, and resilience, which gives me hope that this is a story with a happy ending. So I want to ask, apart from some of the things you've already spoken about, what do we need to change about our society such that we can hear of more happy endings when people find themselves in that valley of mental, you know, depression?
So it's good that for us, who makes up the society? Human beings, right? And definitely it then means that all of us still need to all work hand in hand, all hands on deck to change the narrative. So for society, awareness is all about changing the narrative. Flip it. Don't stigmatize and discriminate people living with mental illnesses. It could be you. Why? Because we are human beings. We are social animals. When we were isolated, you know what happened in the lockdown, how people were all, you know, up and down. They were so angry, and some people even went into depression and were suicidal. Now with this connection and all that, for those of us and for all everybody that is part of this society, is to talk about this mental health as part of our physical health. It's important that we all understand the gravity if you don't build that culture of compassion for people to talk about it. Because what it does is that it will encourage help-seeking behavior, it will allow people to speak up and speak out, and of course it will allow people to get help from the much-needed right people, right places, and right time. And there's no better time than now.
Two quick questions. So the title of the book is Deep Expressions.
Yes.
I'm wondering, does this suggest that when it comes to depression, it's beneath the surface? It's not for everyone to diagnose and everyone to see. And secondly, this couldn't have come at a better time. You talked about the pandemic. Health experts globally, including from the WHO, are warning of elevated mental health stress from the COVID-19 pandemic, mental havoc. Yeah. Is there a coping mechanism? People seem to be so edgy these days.
Oh, Lord, a lot of issues since the COVID happened, mm-hmm. and of course with the lockdown, so much that has happened. So this book, I will tell you for a fact that this wasn't the name at the beginning. It was more of parenting with purpose. And at the end of the day, I'm like, if I put this parenting with purpose, parents will come after me and start telling me that, are you trying to tell me that I'm not parenting well? What are you trying to tell me about this book? I'm not even going to buy. But at the end, when we got this name, Deep Expression, it's just telling you that there's so much more that we need to unravel if we can just pay attention. If you can just know that there's a change that has happened to you or to somebody around you, different from who you were yesterday as against who you are today. So what I will encourage people to do is, what has changed in you from yesterday to today? And if you look in 2-3 days, this change is now affecting your productivity, interpersonal relationship, and day-to-day activities, then seek for help. It's important. There is nothing as good as seeking for help from the right places. We know during the answers there was the word Sorosuke. This is the time for us to use that word, irrespective of the fact that they say it's for millennials and Generation Z. Even if you're an adult, a geriatric person, it is time for us to Sorosuke. Get help. You can't have everything that you need at this point in time. If you can connect with people, right set of people at the right time, and of course, you know, get exercise. One of the coping mechanisms I would recommend for everybody, don't see exercise as keeping fit. See it as, if you exercise, it will boost your feel-good hormones that release those hormones and, of course, called endorphins. And that will reduce fear, anxiety, and mild cases of depression. Imagine if exercise is packaged as a pill. Mm. If exercise is packaged as a pill, everybody will run for it. Aside from exercise, adequate hours of rest, and, of course, eating right, then, of course, I will not go away without saying this. We all have to create boundaries. Yes, with COVID, a lot of our boundaries were eroded, but we need to, you know, be able to create boundaries, have filters. Don't, you know, when you don't understand who you are, your stressors and your triggers, it's easy for people to invade that. So when you create boundaries, you know who and where and what to attend to relate with, and that will also protect, prioritize, and safeguard your mental health.
Okay, I mean, Sorosuke, you say, and we should get help, the right kind of help. But I remember my colleague, Adesua, started off by saying that there are few of you in that field. So what changes, very briefly, have you seen in terms of equipping more specialists like yourself in the area of mental health?
It's going to be worse. It's a time bomb waiting to explode. We have one psychiatrist to 1 million Nigerians. We have more Nigerian psychiatrists in UK than in Nigeria. 3 Nigerian doctors are registered in UK on a daily basis. It's going to be worse. Right now, the Saudi is even recruiting more doctors. The only thing we can do is capacity building, right? Train the trainers. So there's community health extension workers in the primary healthcare. Train them for the basic things regarding what the diagnosis of these different types of mental illnesses are. They can attend to that, and then they will refer to the secondary and tertiary institution. And when these people come back to the community, they can follow up with their follow-up clinics. Mm. Then, of course, the other thing is to get people to read more sciences. Our children. I've got 3 children. None of them want to read medicine. I'm sorry.
Dr. Memuna, where can we find this book?
It's on Flutterwave right now online. Yes, okay. So we can click in and Deep Expression, then on Amazon, e-copy and paperback.
Thank you so much. Dr. Memuna Kadri, author, Deep Expression Psychology Psychiatrist. I read somewhere she's one of the Nigerians with all the 11 P's. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you very much, ladies. It's a pleasure always.